Welcome to the lecture, Applied Mathematical Finance. And in today's session, I like to continue discussing the calibration of our term structure model. So we had a section on the term structure model, the discrete forward rate model, the model formerly known as LIBOR market model. So our model was like that. So just an E2 process for the forward rate. And we specified the model in two different versions. So in this version, every forward rate has its own Brownian driver, but the Brownian drivers could be endowed with an instantaneous, so in infinitesimal time, correlation. Another version of the model, which we introduced a bit later when we realized that an alternative formulation allows for a much more efficient formulation of here our drift term. Another version was this form, where the Brownian driver is decomposed into independent factors, the U's, the DUK. And every factor here has then some, so this here is an independent factor, risk factor or Brownian driver. And then some, every factor had some factor loading. And this was just an equivalent alternative formulation. So the link between the two was that this lambda is actually consisting of the sigma I, okay, and some fik, and the scalar product of two such vectors, fi and fj, is the correlation. So that was our model. And we had started a session on calibration. So calibration is the choice of the three parameters. So how do we choose our parameters? And we already had a session on how do we choose the initial value of the model. So the interest rate curve as we observe it, the initial interest rate curve. We already had a session, how could we choose the sigma I of Tj. And there was a very nice result that, for example, we could link the values of swaptions with different start and end times to the value of these volatilities for different forward rates and different simulation times. So actually simulation times was associated a little bit to the start time of the swaption, and the forward rate here was associated a little bit to the interval and hence the end time of the swaption, so the span of the swaption. There was a nice relation. And today I like to talk a little bit about correlation. Okay, the calibration of the correlations. And so that's the section. And if I move one slide back, I ended the session on discussing here the volatility. So this is the last slide before we move to correlations, by stating that it's possible to reduce the number of values, to reduce, for example, the risk of overfitting by considering a functional form, so a low parameter model for the sigma I. So this here is a low parameter model, so small number of parameters. So this is a low parameter model for sigma I, for all those volatility parameters. So here I only have five parameters. So some linear slope, and then some exponential decay, and then some long-term level. Yeah, so it's parameterized actually backward in time to maturity. And this is like, so I wrote here model. So you see, this is a model within a model. And we will discover the same, or we maybe do the same for the correlation. Okay, that's just a small remark. Yeah, so I finished this in the previous session, but I didn't stress so much here the functional forms. And well, I mentioned that with the sigma, it's actually maybe possible. Yeah, so sometimes it's not possible if there is, for example, arbitrage in the market, or so if the data has some issues. But it's maybe possible to match every swaption observed on your time discretization grid by just choosing this parameter here. Yeah. So if you have a low parameter model, it's not possible to match every financial product because you have fewer parameters than you have financial products. But you could maybe then match the financial products in a least square error sense. So you can minimize some error norm. Yeah. So difference of the market price and the model price, or the difference of the market implied volatility and the model volatility. So something like this. Okay. So now start talking about the calibration of our correlation parameter. So we assumed in number 108. So what is number 108? So that's here our model in this original form. So in this form where I specify a DW for every forward rate, and then I specify the correlation. So we specified here in number 108 a model where potentially each forward rate is driven by its own Brownian motion. So the model is driven by an n-dimensional Brownian motion. So actually the forward rate, the equation for the first forward rate L0 is trivial. Yeah, so but just for consistency, assume that this one is also a Brownian driver. So each forward rate is driven by its own Brownian motion, and the Brownian motions can have here a correlation, an instantaneous correlation. So dwi dwj is rho ij dt. A question is, how do I get this dw? So this is a numerical method. I would like to create a Brownian motion. So in the Euler scheme, I'm looking at a Brownian increment, so dwi. So how do I create now dwi or dwj in a way that they correspond to a correlated instantaneous correlation Brownian motion? Okay, this can be achieved by a numerical tool, the PCA, the principal component analysis. So actually an eigenvalue, eigenvector decomposition of the correlation matrix. So my correlation matrix is now here the input. So of the correlation matrix, so here my indices are running from 0 to n minus 1 because I'm a computer programmer and I number my forward rates from 0 to n minus 1 because I number my time discretization from t0 to tn. But later on the slide, when I talk about linear algebra, I will number the matrices from 1 to n. Yeah? So don't be confused if the index is sometimes starting in 0 and sometimes starting in 1. Okay, so I view the correlation matrix as an input. For example, I will mention later that the correlation matrix can be created by a functional form. And now I view this correlation matrix as an input, and I ask myself, how can I create the DW? So I know how to create numerically independent Brownian increments, because independent Brownian increments are independent normal distributed random variables. A normal distributed random variable can created from a uniform distributed by the inversion of the cumulative distribution function. So I need independent uniforms, and independent uniforms are just given by a sequence or from the random number generator. So if I can create independent uniforms, I can create independent Brownian increments. So assume that we have an independent vector of independent Brownian components, so an independent Brownian motion. So I call this here on the slide U. So this is now U1 to UM. So remember, this goes back to the other alternative formulation. Yeah. So this here is in line with here U1 to UM in this formulation. And I'm linking back actually here to this representation. So we already did this. So I assume that I can represent my DW as a sum. So in the other slide, it was K from 1 to M. Here is J from 1 to M. Fij duk. Okay. So F are here the factor loadings. Again, my question is, how can I find F? So if I have this, then of course the correlation is just the scalar product of Fi and Fj. Yeah, so of the vector Fi and Fj. Okay, so the question is, how can I find F? Before we talk about how can we find F, again on the slide, the small remark that how do we specify R? So given R, we will show how to derive the F. But how do we specify the R? Again, we can specify R by a functional form, say map to a low parameter model for the correlation. So we could specify here the matrix R, our correlation matrix, by a functional form. For example, we could say that, okay, maybe a good model is that interest rates which are close together, they should maybe move very much the same. Yeah? So think of this is like a rope, yeah, or small parts which are attached with springs. Then there is a link between things that are close together, but there's not such a strong link between things that are further apart. So if the things are further apart, maybe this one can move, yeah, but that one here doesn't move so strongly. So maybe you would like to have that the correlation is big, so close to one. Yeah? Correlation big means close to one. If the two things are near to each other. So let's measure the distance of the periods. So the distance of the periods is, where is the fixing time? Where's, what is the difference of the fixing time? And you see if the two are the same, so Ti minus Ti, so Tj is equal to Ti, then this is e to the minus zero, e to the zero, this is just one. And from that, it's exponentially decaying, and things that are far apart are maybe moving more or less independently. Yeah? So our correlation matrix, so if this here is my matrix, so like that, our correlation matrix looks like that, that here we have over one. So here's one, and then here it's exponentially decaying to zero. Huh? So it looks like that. Huh? So maybe this is a nice model and it only has one parameter. In the literature, you can find more general models, yeah, so where the decay is different, but that's maybe a nice one. I would like to already make here a question. Is this always a correlation matrix? So we will see this later again. In order to be a correlation matrix, the matrix has to be one on the diagonal. Okay, that is fulfilled here for this model. But there is another constraint. And the constraint is a little bit linked to the fact that if two variables have a certain correlation, and then if one of the two has a certain correlation with the other, then the three have to fulfill a certain constraint. Yeah. So you cannot have that A has correlation one with B, B has correlation one with C, but A and C have correlation zero. Yeah. So that cannot be. So, and the condition here will be that the matrix R, the correlation matrix, has to be a positive semi-definite. And as far as I remember, there are here choices for alpha where this is not the case. I have to check. But of course, for any functional model, you have to check this. But there's hope. What we will see in a few minutes is you can, like a control variant, take the hammer and correct for this feature. So if a matrix is not positive semi-definite, how can you correct this? The correlation matrix is symmetric. A symmetric matrix has real eigenvalues, and a matrix with real eigenvalues is positive semi-definite if the eigenvalues are larger or equal than zero. So you just check for the eigenvalues and throw away the eigenvalues that are negative. So you can make the matrix, alter it, and you can make it positive semi-definite. Okay, so that's already hinting to what is coming next. So that was a remark on functional form. So functional form is, how do we specify R? This is a model within a model. So again, a model within a model. So in the sense that this is a model for the correlation, and the correlation is part of our interest rate model. Next thing, before I come to this factor decomposition and factor reduction, is when we were talking about this alternative form of the model, the reason that I did this was that there is an efficient implementation of the drift. So if the model is in this form, there is a much faster way of implementing the drift, and it was more efficient if this parameter M here is small. Okay, so that means I like to find a representation of the Brownian motion. Yeah? So that here is my Brownian motion. So this part here is corresponding to my sigma I dwi. So I like to find a representation of the Brownian motion that has a low number of factors, so that has a low value here for the M. If this is the case, the calculation of the drift is much faster, and drift is very expensive calculation in your program. So your program can be much faster. So maybe it's 10 times faster. The M, as it will turn out, is the number of non-negative eigenvalues. So if you come here with such a model that specifies a correlation matrix, we may do a reduction of the factors by considering only the most prominent drivers, so the will be the eigenvalues that are the largest ones, and set all the others to zero. So this is then a factor reduction. Yeah. So in the family of all possible correlation matrix, I restrict myself to the correlation matrices that have rank M, so a small rank. And I only consider correlation matrices in this subspace. Hopefully, it will. This subspace is still rich enough to describe many correlation structures. Yeah. So often we have a big number of forward rates. Yeah, for example, we have 20 years semi-annually, then you have already 40 forward rates. And reducing now the number of factors to 5 or 4 greatly improves the performance of your numerical code. And maybe it's not such a big change to the correlation matrix. So I'm looking for correlation matrix that have very few factors. That's the factor reduction. Then, of course, calibration is how do we choose the three parameters. So initially, my correlation is this three parameter. But if I move to a model with a functional form, then this parameter in the functional form is the three parameter. And you should then specify this parameter, maybe to match financial products that you observe in the market, or to match a correlation structure that you have observed to be historically stable, and you would like to have your model like that. Yeah? So the correlation matrix, so for example, the free parameter, I believe in number 134, it's alpha. So let's fix here the slide. So that is in this equation. This was an alpha. Yeah. So maybe choosing such that the model matches given prices. Well, we have already seen that we can calibrate to the Swaption matrix solely by specifying the time structure of the volatility. So we can specify calibrate to swaptions by using just sigma I. But if you use, for example, a low parameter model for the sigma, then the choice of the correlation can improve your fit to the swaptions. Yeah? So it has an impact on the swaptions. So you could rethink everything in terms of covariance and try to fit the covariance. So I can just think everything in terms of covariance instead of thinking separately in sigma and rho. I could just think of everything in terms of covariance, yeah, and view the covariance as the free parameter. And just specify a functional form for the covariance. So here you see the two functional forms we have looked at. Yeah, of course, they describe a functional form for the covariance. Okay, so that was a little bit discussion about the correlation. Yeah. So the correlation matrix R is the free parameter. We may specify R is a functional form. For our numerical implementation, we need the factors, the FIKs or the lambda IKs, yeah, that create this correlation matrix. And we know that for computational efficiency, it's nice to have a low number of factors. So now it's important to speak about how can we find these factors. So given a correlation matrix, how can you find the factors? And how can you reduce the number of factors? Yeah? So first, how I can decompose a correlation matrix into a number of factors, and how can I reduce the number of factors? So I formulated this as a little lemma. Yeah? So here you have a lemma. I start with a correlation matrix. So a correlation matrix is here my input. Okay, so R is given. So now I'm formulating this just like a lemma, like in linear algebra. So, and for that reason here, my index is starting at 1 and ending at 1. So everything is from 1 to n now. So don't get confused with the previous slide, just a minor modification. So I have a correlation matrix, and that's my input. Maybe this correlation matrix is estimated by some procedure or specified by some functional form. So I start with a correlation matrix. A correlation matrix has certain properties. So the correlation matrix is symmetric, of course. On the diagonal, I have one, and it is positive semi-definite. Okay, so this implies by symmetric, I know that R has only real eigenvalues. So R has real eigenvalues. So this is implied because it is symmetric. And I know that the eigenvalues are larger equal to zero because this is implied by the positive semi-definite. So correspondingly, since I have only real eigenvalues, I can now construct an orthonormal basis of eigenvectors. So an orthonormal basis of eigenvectors exists. Okay, so let's call them V1 to Vn. And I can represent the matrix R in terms of this eigenvector basis and the eigenvalues. So the representation of the matrix R is VD, V transposed, where V is the matrix there, where the columns are the eigenvectors. So here is the matrix V. The columns are the eigenvectors. And the matrix D is the diagonal matrix where you have lambda I on the diagonal. Well, this is just the eigenvector equation. Yeah. So you know, if V is an eigenvector of a matrix, then you have R times VI is lambda I VI. Yeah? Okay. So now you write this in matrix form and throw the VI on the other side. Yeah. With the transposed, yeah. So the transposed is the inverse because it is an orthonormal basis, yeah. And then you have this expression here. So I can represent R in this form, or if I multiply from the left and the right with this matrix, the basis transformation, then I get this diagonal matrix. So I have this nice representation or this nice transformation of my correlation matrix. And from this, I can now find the factor matrix F, so the factors which I need to construct this correlated Brown in motion. So the claim is now that if you set dw, so dw is a vector. So the vector of Brownian motions. So this is a column vector. In every element, I have the dwi, yeah, driving my forward rate. So here dw1 to dwn. Then I can create this vector by taking V times square root of D. Square root of a diagonal matrix is just element wise, the square root applied to these elements here, and these elements are larger or equal than zero, so I can take here the square root, multiplied with du. And here on this slide, u is a vector, also a column vector, of independent Brownian motions. Yeah? So here I have independent Brownian motions u, also a column vector. So this means I multiply here every u with the corresponding lambda, yeah, and then this lambda scaled u is driving here each column vector of the matrix V. Yeah? Okay, so then if I do this, then my Brownian motion has the desired property that dwi dwj is rho ij dt. Okay, so why is that? Okay, it's easily seen if you write it in vector notation. In vector notation, it is the correlation matrix is the matrix dwi dwj. So it is multiply the vector, the correlation matrix dt. So to be formally correct, this is r dt here. R dt is dwi dwj for every ij, so the matrix. So RDT is dw times dw, and this guy here is transposed. So this is now a column vector multiplied with the row vector. So because matrix multiplication is row times column, it is each element of dw with each element of dw. Yeah? So column multiplied with row gives me a matrix. Yeah? So row times column, where each element is multiplied with each element. Okay, so and then I just plug now the definition in. My definition is that dw is a v square root d du. So this is v square root d du. The same stuff transposed. If I transpose this, the order is reversed. So it's du transposed square root of d. D transposed is just the same. It's a diagonal matrix. V transposed. So this guy here in the middle is every du with every du, dui, duj. This is just identity dt. And I have that this is just v square root d, v transposed. And this is just v, d, v transposed. Ah. Okay, so I missed the dt. Yeah, so let's add the dt. Yeah, to be 100% correct. So this is dt. So the correlation of my Brownian motion here is the given RDT. So maybe here I can remove this here and we have this as a proof. We have a proof that this correlation, this Brownian motion here has the given correlation matrix R. Okay, so if you have a correlation matrix, determine the eigenvalues and eigenvectors. From the eigenvalues and eigenvectors, build this matrix here. So this matrix here is now my matrix F. Build this matrix, and then this matrix multiplied with the uncorrelated Brownian motion gives you the correlated Brownian motion. So this lemma tells us how we can build correlated Brownian motions from uncorrelated ones, how we can introduce the correlation. Here is a little bit more to the proof. Yeah? So why is a correlation matrix positive semi-definite? Yeah, you can just check this, and if you have this, then you know that the eigenvalues exist. The eigenvectors can be chosen orthonormal, and then we can you can just check here this. Okay, so now we know if we have a certain correlation, how we can find this alternative form of our model. Yeah? So how we can find here this representation. That means how can we find here the matrix F. Yeah? So this here written in matrix notation is DW is F times DU. Well, with a matrix that is n by n, yeah, the matrix is n by n. Yeah, here is an M. The matrix we have just found is still n by n. Yeah, because I have here n eigenvalues, and my basis, my orthonormal basis. Here, my orthonormal basis has n eigenvectors. So everything is here in n. So my matrix F, which I have found here, is an n by n matrix. But look what happens if an eigenvalue is zero. This can, for example, happen, yeah, if the correlation matrix has rank just smaller than n. For example, rank one. Yeah? Think, for example, of the correlation matrix that is always one. All factors move the same. Everything is perfectly correlated. This correlation matrix has rank one. Yeah? So 1, 1, 1 is an n-fold is the eigenvector, yeah? And then I have two eigenvectors which are zero. Okay. So what happens if there are? So what happens in the situation when lambdas are zero? So when lambdas are zero, it means that look here. It means that a Brownian motion, one of the independent ones, is multiplied with zero. And then the vector that is here in this factor loading is also multiplied with zero. So it means that actually Vn doesn't occur. Yeah? Assume that lambda n is zero. Vn doesn't enter into the game. And Un also doesn't enter into the game. It means that you can just remove it. You do not need to generate the random number. You do not need to generate the random number. And you do not need to use it in the matrix multiplication. So it means that you do not have this guy here in this sum. So you can think of this sum here actually running up to n. But from m plus 1 to n, the vectors are all zero. Because here we have multiplied such a vector, yeah, so such a column with a zero. Okay, so this is but this is now a nice idea. Yeah? Assume that we have specified a correlation matrix. Well, if we have specified, for example, the correlation matrix that is always one, it has rank one, and we know that only the first lambda is maybe different from zero, is different from zero, and the others are all zero. So we can represent the matrix F by just a single column. But what if we have specified a correlation matrix that has rank n, yeah, so has actually n eigenvalues that are larger than zero, but they are very many are very close to zero. Just because we have not specified the matrix nicely enough. Well, we can maybe just remove these eigenvalues, so the eigenvalues that are small, from the construction. And this is then the factor reduction. Yeah? So we reduce the number of factors. Also note that here the the V's, this is an orthonormal basis. So all the vectors have length, so norm one. So they are different directions. So the V's actually describe the direction of the movement. For example, everything is moving in parallel. This is the vector 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. Yeah? So 1, 1, 1, 1, 1 doesn't have norm 1, so you have to scale it. Yeah? But the direction is 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. Assume that, for example, 1 moves up, 1 moves down. Yeah? That's also a direction of a movement. So this here describes the shape of the movement. So this describes the shape of the movement. You also see that here every random number is multiplied with square root of lambda. So this is a little bit like a sigma I dui. So this is the strength of the movement. So this is the strength of the movement, and this is the shape of the movement. Okay, so if you have, for example, the correlation matrix where correlation is always one, yeah, everything is one, 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 then you have that there is a strong movement in parallel direction, but all the others have strength zero. All other directions, all orthogonal directions have strength zero. They don't move at all. So we have a nice interpretation of this correlation matrix. So going back to factor reduction, I would maybe just reduce the matrix to a certain rank by throwing away eigenvalues which have small strengths. And you already see here, I have ordered my eigenvalues. So this should be provided by your numerical algorithm. Otherwise, you can just resort here the basis. So this is now our factor reduction. I would like to reduce the number of factors. So we start with a given correlation matrix. From our given correlation matrix, I construct, so this here is my F. I construct the number of factors, and I observe that I have n factors. So we have that R is given by VD V transposed. My F is given by V square root D. So this means the Fi, yeah, a column of this matrix, is actually just a lambda I times Vi, yeah, a scaled eigenvector. And I just throw away the smaller ones. So I prescribe some m smaller than n, and I just select the m largest eigenvalues. So my eigenvalues are ordered here. So the m largest are just the ones from 1 to m. I just select here the guys from 1 to m. And this defines here some FRK, so a reduced matrix. So this here is now an N by M matrix. Well, how do I do this? I construct this matrix by just using the FIK. We have to be a little bit careful. What is the scalar product or the norm of Fi? Yeah. So Fi multiplied with Fi, the scalar product of Fi with Fi, is the correlation rho ii. So it has to be 1. So note that the sum Fik, Fik, has to be 1, k from 1 to N. Okay. If you throw now away, some parts here, then it's not guaranteed that this is still one. Okay, so the correlation of the guy with itself is smaller than one. You have reduced a little bit the movement. So if you throw away eigenvalues and eigenvectors from this, where the eigenvalue is not zero, then you have maybe removed something from the correlation matrix such that the diagonal is no longer one. So you have to rescale this. So I divide by the norm of the remaining vector. So I divide here by the norm of the vector, and this is the vector. Maybe there's the description here missing. So L from 1 to M. Okay, so I divide by this norm. Yeah. So this here is the L. So I rescale these vectors, and then they will construct the new correlation matrix. So then we construct the correlation matrix from this. So correlation matrix R, yeah, reduced is F reduced multiplied with F reduced transposed. Yeah? So you know here R is VD V transposed. So R is actually equal to F times F transposed. You reduce the matrix by removing certain columns, rescaling the rows, yeah, so that row times column will give you again one, yeah, so for the correlation matrix, and you construct the reduced correlation matrix. So that's factor reduction. And this is very important because we know that if we have a small m, if we reduce the number of factors, the drift is much faster, the program is much faster. And also, you can use this technique to ensure that the matrix is positive definite. Yeah, by just throwing away or setting to zero all the eigenvalues that are negative. So the factor reduction is actually a principal component analysis, singular value decomposition, whatever you use here to describe that you determine eigenvalues, eigenvectors, and you renormalize the rows, yeah, to match this constraint. Again, that is a correlation matrix. So here I have a few pictures how this looks like. But to conclude, actually, I would like to explore this in a computer program. So maybe you can give me 2 or 3 more minutes to explore this. So I have a small Java applet that does this. So actually, this is just using the code which we also use in the library. So in the library here, there is correlation model exponential decay, a correlation model exponential decay, which is just this exponential a, exponential minus a ti minus tj. And you see that when this matrix is constructed, he will just do what was on the slides. So he will use the exponential minus a ti minus tj absolute value to construct a correlation matrix. Well, this is a candidate for a correlation matrix. And then he will perform the factor reduction, which we just use. So calculate the matrix F. And from this matrix F, he will then calculate a new correlation matrix. And I have a small Java applet, which just does this. So here is exponential minus a absolute value ti minus tj. And if here this A parameter is zero, then this is the matrix, which is just always one. So this little example here is now the matrix R, where every element is one. No? So it means the eigenvector is just here, the factor is just a single factor F1. This factor is just 1, 1, 1, 1. Yeah? Or in this case, it's just 3. So everything is moving in parallel. So I have a single Brownian motion, du, and every forward rate gets the same du. Okay, and here you see the matrix. So here you see this is the blue color is one, and the matrix is always 1, 1, 1, 1, 1. You can play a little bit with this tool here and create different versions. For example, what happens if we choose here a little exponential decay? Then you see that suddenly here the eigenvalues, eigenvectors, so these are the factors, get some shape. And this shape looks a little bit like the Fourier modes. So this here is corresponding a little bit to a parallel movement. Everything is moving up and down simultaneously. So if you have a du multiplied with this vector, every du, everyone gets the same punch, the same hit. So this is my du1. And then the du2, what is du2? Given. The next independent movement is here, this green one. So this is like a tilt. Yeah, so it's up, moving up at the front, moving down at the end. Yeah. So everyone, if there is a random number pushing this, then the front is moving up or down, depending on the sign of the random number. And the end of the curve is moving in the opposite direction. And the next one is the blue one here. This is a little bit like bending, yeah? So this is a bending of the curve. And you see these eigenvectors, eigenvalues, these factors, yeah? So these are here the factors. They have a nice interpretation. These factors are the movements, the shape of the curve that is possible, the possible movements. And if we now reduce the number of factors to 5, then we move to this picture. We just single out the first 5 movements. If we single out the first 5 movements, you see that I have the parallel movement, the tilt, the bending, and also the other modes. And you also see here small little changes in the shape. Look here, this looks a little bit different from this. Okay, and this little change in the shape is due to the fact that each column here has to have norm 1, because each dw multiplied with each dw is dt, has correlation 1. So each column here has norm 1. This is the renormalization. So the fact that we have here, this is from renormalizing, the shape, from renormalizing the vectors to create a correlation matrix, there is a small distortion, but we have essentially the same movements. So this is 5 factors. If I change here the number of factors, you can see I can extract from this picture here a different number of factors. If I just extract one factor, the correlation matrix is 1, 1, 1. If I extract more factors, then you see that the correlation matrix becomes more and more similar. And well, maybe 5 factors is already enough. So you can also change here, for example, this vector. And you see that you can extract more factors with the factor reduction and have a picture like this. So you see that here the difference is visible. Yeah, the correlation matrix is not exactly the same, yeah, but we reduced the number of factors. So to complete here this session, what we do here is this is the original matrix R. From this matrix here, I calculate the factor matrix F. From this factor matrix F, I calculate here the reduced factor matrix FR, where I have removed certain columns. And from this FR, I calculate the reduced correlation matrix R. So here's another example where it is a little bit extreme. If you have a very strong decay here in the correlation, but so you have many different movements. So for example, if the matrix is the identity, everything is uncorrelated, then it means that here every movement has the same strength. Yeah, this is just a different basis of representing the basis 1 0 0 0 0 1 0 0 0 0 0 1 0 0 0. This is just here a different representation of the basis. Every movement is independent. And of course, if you throw away factors from here to here, you remove important parts. So you see the correlation matrix is has a lot of difference. So it's not matching. And you also see this correlation matrix here is 1 on the diagonal where the plot is switched. Yeah. So here it goes, the index goes up here, the index goes up. Yeah. So it's 1 on the diagonal and 0. Yeah. So the green one is 0 elsewhere. And here it is 1 on the diagonal, but there are even regions here where it becomes negative. Yeah, so the correlation matrix has changed a lot. Okay, that was it for today. Thank you.